Darren here with Learn Film Photography. One thing that has always bothered me is the idea that film just works like magic. People in the 1800s were able to figure it out, yet almost 200 years later, people still don't know what's going on. So as someone with a bachelor's degree in journalism, a college dropout understanding of science, and a YouTube channel, I feel it is my responsibility to show you exactly how this stuff works. Because film photography is not magic. When you break it down, it's actually really simple. The difficult part is manufacturing film. In fact, doing so on a large enough scale to make it adoptable by the masses will always be one of the greatest technological achievements in human history, alongside international flight, pasta, and harnessing energy from the sun. All right, but in order to explain this properly, I gotta get into this super serious looking lab coat that I 100% did not purchase just for this video. Hide that tag. While I'm getting this jacket on, I gotta tell you about today's sponsor, which is Soft Grain Books. Soft Grain Books is a small lens-based photo book publisher specializing in fine art and long-form documentary photography. I started this publishing company with another international artist to help bring small projects to life and support the creation and publishing of fine art. When you purchase a book from Soft Grain Books, you're not only supporting LearnFilm.Photography and this channel and education, you are also supporting independent photo book publishing and small artists that make all of this possible. So go check it out at softgrainbooks.com using the link in the description below and sign up for the email list to get your lifetime 10% discount code. Okay, so the lab coat's on, IQ is shot up by 10 points. Now let's get into the science. So film is made of a base layer of acetate or polyester plastic, which is coated with a thin layer of gelatin containing evenly spaced silver halide crystals. Silver halide is a stable but light-sensitive compound made up of silver and a member of the halogen family on the periodic table. Film and paper mostly use bromine for the halides, but it can also use chlorine or iodine, but that's not important for this video. The final layer is a light blocking dye, or remjet, in cinema film. The dyes, or carbon remjet, are water soluble and wash out with the developer, or pre-wash. This leaves the bright blue or green color that you sometimes find when you're developing film. This backing layer stops light from going through the film and bouncing back and then re-exposing the red layer of film, which is known as halation. Halations mostly occur around bright edges on the film, such as around light sources or backlit subjects. If you've ever shot Cinestill 800T, the halation effect is what this film is most famous for. This is a grain. If strong enough light hits the grain, the energy collected allows the silver to bend away from the bromine and into a position on the grain called a hole. In order for the grain to become developable, it needs enough light to make three or more silver atoms to move into holes on the crystal. In open light, this process happens rapidly, making the whole film black. But when this process happens in a controlled environment, like in a light-tight film camera, the silver molecules will be arranged in a pattern that can create an image. The places where more light hits will collect more atomic silver, which allows for a larger and denser grain on the film. This energy collected forms what's known as a latent image, which is a way of saying the image has been recorded but just isn't visible yet. For it to become visible, the film has to be developed. But it's also important to note that this same reaction happens from atmospheric radiation, heat, and even x-rays, which is why it is so important to store your film properly and use it fresh when possible. And now on to the developing step. Film developers are made from a class of reactive chemicals called phenols. Phenols are aromatic compounds found in nearly everything from coffee and tea to legumes, mint, parsley, vanilla, hormones like the happiness hormone serotonin, and the stimulant epinephrine. Phenols are found everywhere because they are part of the amino acid tyrosine, which means the chemical we isolate to develop film plays a fundamental role in all life on Earth. But the developers we get off the shelf use carefully balanced phenols that are more reliably sourced from the petrochemical refining process, like hydroquinone, methyl, and phenidone. Let me know down in the comments below if you're interested in hearing more about film developers and where they come from, as well as other environmentally friendly options. This is something that I'm very passionate about, but I know not everyone is, so let me know down below if that's something you want me to dive into. When the film is put in the developer, the phenols in the developer seek out the grains that have atomic silver that has been struck by light. Phenols like hydroquinone have a hydrogen atom on the outside that wants to break away and find a more stable home. All it needs is just a little bit of energy to break away. The silver molecules that were struck by light and previously absorbed that light energy act as a catalyst and allow the hydrogen to break off of the hydroquinone and form a bond with the bromine.
I love you, bro.
Leaving the resulting silver behind, while the hydrogen, bromide, and quinone wash away. If the film is left in the developer for a long time, eventually that aromatic phenol solution is going to break down the other grains that haven't been exposed to light, which creates something called fog. This is why we use carefully controlled developers. If we used really concentrated solutions or higher temperatures, it will develop the film faster, but it will also create more fog through this process. After the film has been developed, it is still reactive to light. The fixer step uses ammonium thiosulfate to stabilize the film and make it unreactive to light and make it last long term. Ammonium thiosulfate breaks apart the silver halide crystals, forming compounds that are known as dithiosulfatoargentate and ammonium bromide. These two compounds are then able to be fully absorbed into the fixer solution and leave the film completely unreactive. It's important to note that while the developer can go down the drain, the fixer, bleach, and Blix need to be stored and disposed of properly because they contain silver, which is a toxic heavy metal that bioaccumulates downstream. Check out the link below to learn more about safe disposal solutions. Color film uses the same silver halide crystals, but they're trapped in multiple color-sensitive layers that correspond to a specific wavelength of light, and these layers also have a corresponding dye cloud inside of them. So Color Developer uses a chemical known as CD4. So CD4 works exactly the same way as a black and white film developer, except when it develops a black and white crystal, it also has a coupler that releases a dye cloud into the emulsion layer, which creates the color in the film. So after development, color film then undergoes a bleaching step to remove the developed silver from the film. And then it also goes through the same ammonium thiosulfate fixing step to remove the remaining silver halides. If you're developing at home, you probably use Blix, which combines the bleach and the fix to remove all of the silver at once. Now, if you wanted to do a bleach bypass with a Blix kit, you can actually use standard black and white fixer instead of the Blix, which leaves the developed silver on the film while removing all of the undeveloped silver. All right, so that was your 5-minute film tip about how film works. Now, of course, it gets a lot more complicated than this, but understanding the basics of how film works will allow you to figure out different parts of the process where things could be going wrong and how you can improve your film photography. For example, knowing how film works like this, it's also easy to understand why reciprocity failure exists, which is when you're shooting in low light situations, such as at night or with a neutral density filter, the light has less intensity to it. It has less energy hitting the film, which means that you need more time to excite the electrons enough for the silver to break apart from the bromine and make those grains developable. Understanding this process also lets you understand why you need to develop film quickly after shooting. If the film absorbed light energy and that energy is what makes the film developable, then it's easy to understand how that energy over time can leave the silver or it can migrate over to different molecules. The longer you leave film, the more that latent image breaks down, and the effects are especially noticeable in the shadow regions of the image where there isn't as much silver deposited and every grain counts. Now, of course, latent image stability has come miles and miles ahead of where it used to be. Film that was made after the 90s holds its latent image extremely well, but for the best possible images, you'll always want to develop as soon as possible. When you're ready to drill down further, I've got a number of in-depth guides on the Learn Film Photography blog linked below. Learn Film Photography is all about taking a scientific and eco-friendly approach to film, and I hope you guys enjoy it. So if you liked this video, please remember to like and subscribe, and go and check out softgrainbooks.com. If you have any feedback or any questions, feel free to leave a comment down below. I'm very active in the comment section on this channel, and I would love to help you guys out. All right, thanks so much, and we'll catch you guys in the next one.